Her er en dør. Vinduet. 1, 2, 3, 4. Så banker vi på. Hva kommer nå? Lekestue.
Ja, hei mine venner, og velkommen til en kaffebloggen ekstra. Jeg har lyst til at vi skal prøve å få i gang en skikkelig diskusjon om EUs copyright-direktiv artikkel, ja, både 11 og 13, kanskje da først og fremst 13. Knut mener at jeg er for bastant i mine utsagn, for dommedagsprofet sier at internett vil stoppe 1. januar. Det vil jo selvfølgelig ikke da. Men jeg må si at etter hvert som jeg setter meg inn i dette direktivet, så blir jeg mer og mer skremt. Jeg har jo egentlig ikke sagt så veldig mye selv. Jeg har bare vært litt tabloid, lest overskriftene til de forskjellige videoinnslagene jeg har presentert. Og i dag så har jeg tenkt å presentere et veldig, veldig langt et i denne kaffebloggen ekstra. Det er, ja, dere så gjerne kaffebloggen i dag. Han som snakket om artikkel 13, han har en livestream-kanal. Den er jo vel verdt å abonnere på, egentlig. Jeg tenkte bare vi skulle vise den lange streamen hans her nå. Og så for all del, altså, jeg vet veldig lite om EUs copyright-direktiv. Jeg prøver bare å få i gang en diskusjon, jeg. Og jeg mente ikke å være sur på noen i morges. Jeg var bare, ja, jeg har en litt syk form for humor og ironi. Men nå får vi få med oss hele livestreamen hans.
Good evening, YouTubers. I hope you're having a wonderful day. It's Tuesday, 8 p.m., our regularly scheduled live stream. I hope everybody's doing incredibly, incredibly well. I'm in Miami Beach. Weather is just perfect. We are about in the mid-80s, not too hot, not too cold. Once in a while, we get a nice breeze. Winter is definitely our season. It's when, you know, it's when everybody makes here a great deal of money from tourism as people travel here, so this is the season for us to be considered very, very lucky, and I absolutely love winter here. As always, this is going to be a live stream. That means it's about you and me having a conversation as best we can in given the tools that we provided. So it's all about you putting down questions, me responding it, you putting down comments, telling me I'm wrong, telling me that you think otherwise. Everything is welcome. Just remember one thing, as always, you'll have once in a while, you'll have little pop-up things at the bottom to remind you, but when you want to ask a question or you want me to read out your comment or you want me to respond to something, just make sure to put an @YouTuberLaw before your comment. On my end, it's going to show as an orange box. It's going to tell me you want me to read your comment. Usually we get lots of comments, so I can't go through everything, but if you put an @YouTuberLaw, that will tell me to read it, and I always go through all of that. Obviously, if you do a super chat, I will pay extra attention, but you don't have to do. You don't have to pay. You don't have to do anything special. Just put an @YouTuberLaw to let me know that this is what you're interested in. Yeah, if you're not sure exactly the spelling, sometimes one word, sometimes two. If you just start, put an @, start the word YouTube, a couple of letters, it will just pop up. You can click on it. It'll be very, very simple. Before we start, let's just go through the poll to see what I put up this past 24 hours. And this is the question I posed, right? The first one being, will the EU Article 13 kill the internet? And the second one is about Facebook alleged lie as provided through the New York expose. Are they actionable? Now, I know everybody wants to talk about Article 13, but I thought maybe people have had enough from other channels, so maybe you'll guys vote for the Facebook scandal, the expose. Actually, a lot of interesting information came out of that expose by the New York Times. So I guess you made your decision very, very clearly. Let me just go see what everybody's saying. Cons Clanseth, hello, good evening, how you doing? Daniel Candy, did you hear the good news that Britain First won that lawsuit against Facebook in the UK? The court has told Facebook to republish all their pages. No, I did not. That is amazing. I'd love to see a copy of that order. I'll make sure to take a look for it after we finish up. That is definitely from internet law kind of world, earth-shaking. We've not seen anything like that where government requires these platforms to republish pages they took down for any reason. Definitely something in the United States you will never be able to have unless you change a bunch of laws, not just a single law. So that'd be very interesting. Thank you. Zarg, hey man, how you doing? Taldren, will Article 13 affect Great Britain should Brexit actually occur? That's a great question. Going to talk about directly about Article 13 and who's going to be impacted by it. Brexit is a fascinating issue. My thought on it, if you guys are interested, I may just put it up for next week. Talk specifically of some of the Brexit issues and some of the implication. But we'll talk generally about it here as well, obviously, about the impact it's going to have not only on the European Union, obviously, Britain, depending on whether or not it stays or leave. Luckily, it will obviously leave because of Brexit and the rest of the world, because, frankly, everybody's going to be impacted by Article 13, not just the members in the EU. Nuve, hey, how you doing? Glad to finally catch another live stream. Thrilled to have you here. That's outstanding. Like I said before, make sure to put all your comments. We're going to start. I'm just going to do the little intro. Then I'm going to start. I'm going to do maybe like a 10-minute. I promise it's not going to be very long. Like just an exposition. I'm going to go through the actual directive. Normally, people are reading and rereading articles and other people's opinion. I really thought that before we start discussion, we should just really focus on the language. It's not that long to begin with. The directive and actually pull some information directly off of what the European Parliament actually approved. So I think that will be instructive. As it goes along, you have any questions, any comments, just put them down into the stream. Just again, make sure to put an @YouTuberLaw in front of your comments so I'll read it. And once I finish my little 10-minute discussion of the actual law, I'll go back and I'll go through every single one of your questions and comments and discuss it. So let's start the stream. Excellent. In 2015, the European Parliament decided that they're going to, let's say, modernize copyright law. Nobody really paid too much attention. There were some basic principles that they wanted to adhere to, but it didn't really raise anybody's antennas until about 2 years later when the initial draft started circling around and a lot of people saw issues in different one of the articles that being passed. Predominantly, people saw problems in two articles, in Article 11, which was known as the link tax, and Article 13 that's dealt in copyright, also known as the meme censorship bill. When it finally came up to a vote in June, July of this year, it was rejected. Basically, it was not approved, wasn't a huge defeat in terms of numbers in the European Parliament. So we knew it's going to come back. It's not as if it was going to be defeated and we'll never hear about it again. They went back, made some revisions. Some people felt those revisions were pretty simple, nothing really complicated to look at. Some people thought that there was some substance to the revisions. Nonetheless, they proposed new revisions and the European Parliament passed Article 13 as we have it now. This past September, they obviously passed a number of different articles as part of the copyright directive. Nonetheless, what we are going to be discussing today is Article 13. So before we get into our discussions about what's going on, what's the impact, how different people are going to be impacted by it, whether or not small content creator will be negatively impacted, whether that's going to benefit traditional media, what's going to happen to people within the European Union versus people outside of Europe. Let's actually go through the directive itself. It's not very long. Let's go through it and try to analyze it in detail. Here we are. And in front of us are the amendments adopted by the European Parliament on the 12th of September 2018 on the proposal for a directive of the European Parliament and of Council on copyright in the digital single market. Now, what you're going to see is that there's text on both the left and on the right. The left is basically the text that was rejected back in June. The text on the right is what was approved this past September. So what's called amendment that was approved here. And as we start on the top, it says use of protected content by online content sharing service providers, storing and giving access to large amounts of work and other subject matter uploaded by their users. Now, that alone should give you some pause here, because there's some real questions about what do people mean by that, even though it's just the preamble to the entire directive here. First of all, it talks about the use of protected content. What is that? Is every single piece of copyright information protected content, or is it copyrighted data minus anything that otherwise would be exempted? Mainly, it's actually things that will be actionable. So if there's some material that is subject to fair use, you have copyrighted material minus fair use, and that's going to be protected content. That's not really clear here. Next, it says, by service providers storing and giving access to large amount of work. Now, what you see here is the beginning, they make reference to protected content, and then they're saying giving access to works. So it seems, at least by the language here, because there are a lot of time to go back and forth, that there are two different things we're talking about. Now, obviously, because we know that from other discussions, the Parliament intends this directives to apply to larger social networks. So they want to make sure that smaller social network that might give access and ability for users to actually post content, they want to make sure that the smaller social media networks, they're not impacted, as a way basically of encouraging competition among smaller companies. Unfortunately, the way it's written makes absolutely no sense here. Because first of all, what kind of content are you discussing? And then you're discussing companies that are providing access to large amount of works. So if you assume that YouTube is such a company providing access to large amount of work, are we talking about works as being all content? Or are we talking about works as being infringing work? Meaning companies that provide access to a lot of infringing work will be subject to this directive, but companies that provide access to very small percentage or very small quantity of copyright infringing work would not be. So is small based on all work provided by the company, or just the amount of infringing content? You understand that there could be a small company that encourages tremendous amount of infringing content on their property, and yet it's possible to read this law saying that they will not be impacted because numerically the amount of work on their platform is relatively small, while a company such as YouTube and more established companies that actively fight against copyright infringement, and the percentage of infringing work is relatively small on their platform relative to non-infringing work, they might actually get caught and be called large company and subject to this regulation, while smaller companies with a lot of infringing work would not be. Part of the problem with the way they wrote it, because there's no doubt that they're going after the large social media companies, YouTube, Google, Facebook, Twitter, but not clear why. Is it because of the amount of infringing work, or is the amount of total work on their platform? Next, it says, online content sharing service providers perform an act of communication to the public. Now, take a look at that again, because that's critically important. It says, online content sharing service provider perform an act of communication to the public. They perform an act of communication. Now, what does that actually mean? Normally, if I'm posting something to YouTube, I'm communicating with the audience. YouTube is not. That's traditionally how it's been looked upon. The YouTube is a platform. Here they're changing, and it says that when a user posts something, It's the platform that is communicating to the public. And that's in many ways earth-shattering. This is something we have never seen before. Now, I know people, a lot of people within the United States feel that some of the laws in the United States that shield these content providers, these platforms from liability should be removed, maybe rolled back to the way it was pre-1996 before the Communication and Decency Act was actually passed. Back then, before we had Section 230 that gave immunity, there was a distinction between whether or not somebody's a publisher versus an editor. Are you just posting somebody else's content, or are you actively involved in the content itself, which is the way, let's say, a newspaper editorial process would be. So the issue becomes, what if you are more of an editor, somebody that integrally, that is involved in the content in one way or another, like curating the content, you might be liable for the content. That's the way newspapers are, versus publishers who are just posting everything. Now, it does, in the United States, it doesn't matter. That distinction no longer matters after the passage of Section 230 in 1996. But maybe people say, no, let's go back to the old era where that distinction was actually important. In Europe, what is being proposed is far more radical. It's not a distinction between publisher and editor, is that the very act of somebody putting content on a platform makes the platform a speaker, basically put them on par with the content creator himself. It doesn't make a difference if you're posting something and not doing anything to it. It's the very act that you allow somebody to post to your platform that means that you are now a communicator with the actual end user. They shall therefore conclude fair and appropriate licensing agreement with the rights holder. So you see what's going on here, since they say that the platform is now a speaker here, that the platform now needs a licensing agreement directly with the rights holder. Normally what you have is the content creator who needs to get a license with the original owner of whatever copyrighted work he's using, either that or rely on fair use. But now they're saying, by virtually of allowing somebody to post content to your site, you are now obligated to get a license from them. Do you see what's going on here? It basically shifts the entire costs of licensing from the content creator to YouTube. Don't kid yourself. Right now, if I want to put a piece of music on my video, and I did right in the intro to this video, I had a piece of music. I had to pay a licensing company to provide me permission to use their video. It was my cost and I had to bear it. Sometimes it's a one-time fee, sometimes it's a monthly fee, depending on what kind of a service. Now, effectively, that shifts, because now when I put something on YouTube, if I'm within the EU, YouTube would be required to negotiate agreement and pay effectively for that content. I'm basically absolved of any responsibility. I don't have to acquire a license because YouTube is. And you'll see in a second what I mean by that. Let's just go to the next section here. And it says, the licensing agreement shall cover the liability for works uploaded by the users of such online content sharing service, provided that such users do not act for commercial purposes. So the license that YouTube needs to negotiate basically has to include the right to broadcast the content of the copyright owner on behalf of the content creator. So as long as the content creator is not commercializing his video, YouTube is paying for the license the content creator otherwise would have to have gotten from the music company. Now YouTube has to do that. It's just a shift of cost from the user to YouTube. You can imagine how that level of absurdity would not be desirable by any platform. Why would a platform want to have to negotiate agreements like that and pay fees that cover the content creator? Now, they do mention the fact that as long as it's not commercial, now it's not clear to happen what, not clear what would happen in the event that it is a commercial, and what is commercial is a video that's actually monetized? Is that commercial, or is it a video that actually is done on behalf of a commercial enterprise, a company? Is that commercial, or is it something that maybe gets sponsored by a third party? Is that commercial? That's not clear. That's something they can work themselves out when they go through some of the details. Nonetheless, the idea here ultimately is shift the cost, because don't kid yourself, the music industry here doesn't want to sue the content creator. The content creator takes their music, may or may not pay them a licensing fee, but why would the content, what music company want to sue them? One individual, one instance doesn't pay them. Yeah, YouTube provides them stuff like Content ID that may allow them to monetize, but that's not what they want. They want to file one lawsuit attached to it, 1,000 different claims, all dealing with different music that's been infringed upon, and charge YouTube for it. And that's what this whole thing is about. It's all about shifting the responsibility and the cost for licensing away from the content creator toward the platform. Now, they can always sue the content creator, but that's not what they want to. They want to be able to go after YouTube. So effectively, this new directive would shift the responsibility of actually acquiring a license away from content creator and impose all that costs on the platform itself. Member states shall provide that where rights holder do not wish to conclude licensing agreement, online content sharing service providers and rights holder shall cooperate in good faith in order to ensure that unauthorized protected work or other subject matter are not available on their service. What that actually means is unclear. Yes, if me as a music professional don't want to give you license to my music, we nonetheless have to cooperate in good faith so that my music does not show up on your platform. The problem with that is there's lots of exception that might allow that work to actually be on the platform. Where do they have written that the fact fair use would be exempted from it? And worse than that, because there is some discussion outside of these actual words that where the parliament member says, no, we're going to include an exception for fair use and other such standard exception. The problem here is not that there will be a legal exception to that here. It's because by setting up this system, YouTube cannot take the chance. By saying that you'll exempt fair use, well, YouTube cannot be in a position to make a determination with each and every upload whether or not fair use applies or not, since there's no sort of umbrella protection to them based on their actions as written into this directive. They would have to assume that every instance of upload to which they don't have a license is an instance of copyright infringement, and they would have to take it down. There is just no other way for them to act. There's no way for a company to make an assessment of a possible exception, because there is no clear laws, definitely not within the United States, but not in Europe either, as to those exceptions for that matter across the world. The exceptions are very, very difficult to determine. So unless they come up with some rule here that make exception exceptionally clear and provide some sort of an umbrella from liability to those platform if they make those determinations and according with the standard set, the only thing YouTube, Facebook, Twitter can do is actually assume that every upload instance of somebody else's content is infringing. They cannot take the risk. Cooperation between online content service providers and rights holders shall not lead to preventing the availability of non-infringing works or other protected subject matter, including those covered by exception or limitation to copyright. Completely nonsensical sentence. Now, maybe they'll flush it out in their final wording and what they're going to expect. Maybe. But this is the best they came up with, that the failure to get some sort of a license agreement should not serve as the basis for actually excluding things that otherwise are permitted, like fair use and other sort of copyright exceptions. None of that will have any impact unless they provide clear standards of what these platforms have to do. And if they do that, say that they are not liable. It's the only way to make sure those platforms do not take down basically non-infringing content. Online content sharing service providers must put in place effective and expeditious complaint and redress mechanism. And here it says, member states shall also ensure the users have access to an independent body for the resolution of disputes, as well as to a court or other relevant judicial authority to assert the use of an exception or limitation to copyrighted rules. What are they saying here? And that's just probably the dumbest idea I've seen here so far. Well, they all recognize that there has to be a mechanism for people to argue that you took down my work, but it's really not infringing. I should put it back up. Now, since they are not relying on a mechanism like the DMCA or similar process by which somebody then actually declares it's not infringing, at which point he assumes liability and the platform that therefore is not liable, and they are free to put the content ban back up without any sort of liability. What they basically saying, no, content must be taken down and you then must go effectively to the state for a form of resolution. The process by which the content may be placed up has to go through the state, not directly through the platform. Now, the platform may have some sort of a resolution, but why would YouTube ever put a resolution process on their platform that then would allow people to put their work up back up when it still would retain potential liability for those work? That's why this is idiotic. If you guys were not happy with the way YouTube handles the entire redress process, how you have to appeal it, it may take time. Sometimes you feel that they're not really listening to you. They give you a small box, very few characters. You really can't have a discussion and a way to explain it to them. And there's only one opportunity to appeal. You can't have a back and forth conversation. As much as you don't like that process, that is incredibly effective process and a desirable process relative to what the EU is proposing, where basically they want you to go to the state. They're going to create a process through the state, through the court system, effectively, where you can go seek redress for the fact that your content was put down and effectively get some sort of a court order that you can take back to YouTube so YouTube puts it back up. If right now YouTube can take your video down in seconds after your upload, imagine how long it's going to take before you can actually get your video back up once it's taken down. If you have to go through a process that's somehow mediated through the legal system or through some administrative process set up and monitored by the state, it'll be disastrous. Now, that's pretty much what's been passed. There's obviously lots of discussions that and commentary made during the process, so we have more information based on all of those commentaries and some promises to be made. This is in no way final. This is not effective. The way it works, for those of you who are not in the EU, basically the parliament approved it. This goes back now. There is a negotiation process where they're trying to come up with kind of like the detailed and final wording before it then goes back to each individual country. And then each individual country then has 2 years in which to pass a law that is in some way adhering to the very principles that are going to be expressed in whatever the European Parliament actually finally passes. Now, just by going through that, you can see why people have had so many problems with this. Obviously, there's a lot of other issues. People have often said this will kill memes, because inherently there is no true grasp in the legal system, not in Europe, not in the United States, whether or not memes are really copyright infringement, or are there parodies, are they satirical, are there commentary or educational, depending on the content itself. As a result, it would pretty much force the platforms to take down all those memes. But that's true about just about everything. There's no way for platforms to know of the legal status of any content you upload with somebody else's content included, whether that's music, video, or any other things like photograph. And as a result, they'll have to assume that it's infringing, take it down, and then force you to basically go through a process that would actually take place through the state to figure out if you can bring it back up. Now, the question is, who does it actually apply to? Who's going to suffer through Article 13? Well, definitely it's going to be people residing within Europe. We don't have the final details of what it's going to look like, but there's a couple of different implications here. Will there be some sort of a geofence around Europe so that European residents have less access to material that the rest of the world have? So whatever content is being produced outside of Europe will not basically enter Europe as long as it includes third-party content within it, because the risk is that much greater, as well as content produced within Europe as well. All of that either will be barred from being shown in the EU or taken down and then be subject to this kind of state-based and moderated appeals. So you can see very quickly how everybody's impacted, because if you're a content creator, if you have something to say, if you want to discuss an issue that is either relevant to the whole world or to the EU, even if you're not within the EU, that may act to actually bar your expression from reaching EU residents. Now, everybody talks about how this is a dire thing, and it might be, but... And I've written a blog post on it this past week. I'll leave a link down below if you guys are interested in reading. The way humanity works is we adjust. We learn what the rules are and we adjust to those rules. And it rarely, if ever, especially in free countries such as the European Union, is it going to act as a barrier to speech. What's likely going to happen is going to act as barrier to the inclusion of third-party content. Think about it this way, and it's not particularly desirable. If I had to create content within the EU, if I did it for the United States, say I did a review of the latest movie involving the Harry Potter world, the Crimes of Grindelwald, I may include clips from the movie in my exposition, in my discussion, so I can actually show it. But when I want it to be distributed within the European Union, I may actually use stock footage that I pay a service to provide, and it's going to be less effective, less entertaining, and probably just less successful within the EU, but doesn't mean necessarily that my speech is going to be barred, but rather that I will have to adjust it in order to reach the maximum number of people within the EU, because it's potentially can be considered copyright infringing within the EU, and then YouTube would take it down. So try to avoid it being taken down. I might use licensed content in order to get by it. And I think that at least in the beginning, as after this law is actually passed and it passes within all the different states included within the European Union, what you're going to have is a period of adjustment where people look at the rules and say, okay, how do I get around it? And it's going to be not as nice, not as effective, not as entertaining. But it's people are going to find creative ways of actually sending their message to residents within the EU, just in ways other than the way they express themselves outside of the EU. Anyway, that's my thought on the matter. Let me know what you're thinking. Nate, thank you so much for the super chat. I appreciate it. Would email fall under the umbrella of these laws? Secondarily, what might the effect be on scholarly work or such other things that must by nature use citations, which are a little different than links? So within Article 13, this is not likely to impact email, because we're talking about platforms that then actually allow people to upload and actually basically communicate to users through it. YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, email platforms and companies that run email servers don't have the same kind of functionality, so Article 13 would not actually apply to them. Now, would it apply to scholarly work? Absolutely. And the question is, well, will they be liable for the platforms? Well, the problem is that if you ask the parliamentarians whether or not you'll be able to put educational material up, they say, absolutely, we're going to put an exception to educational material, which is, I'm absolutely certain that they will. There's a problem here. Who determine if something you create is educational, but something that I create is not? Who says that what you're doing is scholarly, but what I'm doing is entertainment? The problem is, unless they create some sort of umbrella, a shield from liability to these platforms to make those determinations, they're going to have to assume it's all infringing. And so scholarly educational stuff would have to be taken down unless there's some sort of a way to resolve who the liability. Now, the way they're writing the law right now, it doesn't seem that there could be a liability shift. Meaning, one way to resolve this would say, how about if I, through the process, maybe by taking it down or through some sort of a preliminary scan, I determine that third-party content is included, me as in YouTube. And then I request as a condition to put it up, saying, you're saying it's educational, I'm concerned, I want to have there be a shift of liability where you assume the liability that otherwise I would have. If it has legal backing and there is in fact a shifting of liability, that could allow it. I don't think that that the European Parliament will allow something like that. They don't want there to be a shifting of liability, because that's effectively what can take place through the terms of service. They want liability to remain on YouTube. As a result, there is absolutely no way for anybody to figure out what is scholarly or what's not. At least YouTube cannot figure it out. So yes, legally, you would be permitted to post it, but effectively, YouTube would have to take it down until they can be assured that they are not liable. And how long that takes, the best way for them to do it from a legal perspective is to say, you know what, take it to the locally instituted and mediated court system set up through the European Parliament, so that that when you come out of it, you give us a court order that then absolves us of any sort of liability. That's probably going to be the best process for YouTube, which is the worst process, because effectively does not mean that you can actually create something, post it, show it, and it be timely. You're probably going to have to take weeks, if not months, as it goes through a process that is relatively new, that nobody has figured out yet through the state court system or administrative system to figure out, yeah, what you did, it was scholarly. YouTube can put it back on and not be liable for it. So exceptions, yes, but I don't see how any of those exceptions can effectively work in such a way as to allow timely uploads. What the likely resolution is going to be is that YouTube is going to sign deals with large newspaper, large media companies, large YouTubers, people that they feel they can trust, people that they feel, you know, understand what the new law is and are not going to use copyrighted material. And as long as that trust remains, YouTube is going to allow those media outlets and those larger content creators access to the EU. And everybody else will be rejected, and will have to go through the state mediated process, which has the effect of what many suspect the EU Parliament actually wanted, which is give a boost to traditional media and effectively put the kibosh on content creators and small creators. That's probably what's going to happen. Let me see where we're starting here. John Ferguson. Oh, yeah. Again, a reminder, everybody, put at YouTuber Law in front of your comment. I'm only going to read comment that says at YouTuber Law, because that actually gives me an orange box here. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, John. Travelers, serious question. How might this affect VPN users? As in, will VPN become less secure as people try to use them to get around potential internet blockages? Look, any sort of mechanism that allows you to get around that in all likelihood will not be will be effective, right? As long as Google cannot ascertain that you're using VPN, you should be able to gain access to everything, because Google is going to be concerned about your location. If you somehow mask your location, they will not block you. It will make absolutely no sense for them to do it, because ultimately they want to have as much content as possible. So if you're in the EU and you've engaged a VPN that shows that you're in San Francisco, they will not block it. Now, you have to understand that these platforms over time have become much, much better in detecting VPNs. So, you know, used to be that you can go all over Europe and watch American version of Netflix in Europe, but now Netflix has been detecting a lot more VPN. So you just have to know which VPN can actually get around the Netflix detection mechanism. So I think the business is going to be very, very good for VPNs that going to figure out how to get around the detection system of Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. Eric Ahim Azel. It seems important that they establish consistent language at the beginning of this document, especially the multilingual nature of the EU. Any thoughts on why they're being so vague? Yes, because you've got an enormous body of people that while they are elected by their country, they're not as answerable to their country, not the way local politicians are. And so they're trying to kind of ride the middle way. If you think our Congress in the United States are ineffectual and never get anything done, in the EU, they are getting things done, but kind of riding the middle. They know what they want, but they don't want to put any detail. If we actually went through, and I don't want to go through too many of those details, on the left column was their original language. And the original language, for instance, encouraged platforms to actually have preemptive scanning. Now, why not say, you know what? If you have a scan and it's capable of catching, you know, X percentage of infringing material, that should provide you liability. They've removed that and just said, you know, platform are going to be completely liable for it. So right now, in order to pass, in order to get all these people from all of these countries that have completely disparate ideas of what the law should look like to agree to it, they basically had to remove a lot of those kind of details that people thought of originally. So the law that's most likely to pass, in this case not a law, a directive that's most likely to pass is one that has as few details as possible, and that will leave the details to later negotiations. So it should come up. I believe it's supposed to be in January of 2019 when the next version is supposed to be signed on, kind of the final version that the parliament will actually vote on. But it's my suspicion that you'll see the same kind of thing. Rather vague language that a lot more people would be in agreement on, that then would force the detail on the member countries for them to resolve in their own parliaments. The 3D video, part one. The largest YouTube competitor in Europe is Dailymotion, who hosts a lot of copyright infringing content, which can be found by keyword, let alone a content ID system. Part two. Which would give the Trump administration a reason to sanction the EU if this becomes law. Part 3, aka Article 13, is a mess that makes sense considering the EU claims to be against populism, but it is written in the most anti-US company populist way possible. End. So, a couple of things. I mean, is the EU directive an anti-US company law? Possibly. I mean, it's definitely anti large social media company if you consider the fact that the largest social media companies in the world are US based. You can then say, well, it's anti US. is can they use such things as large versus smaller as a way to focus on YouTube but not on Dailymotion potentially? And that's why you have also some of those inconsistency. Are they talking about a lot of infringing material or a lot of material, period? Why should a company that has a lot of non-infringing material, a vast amount of non-infringing material, be subject to a directive where a smaller company may have a greater percentage of infringing material? None of that is clear. So can this then be used as the basis for some sort of a trade war? Potentially. Effectively, that's not my concern, because if the United States wants to shoot itself in the foot by getting to trade war over this kind of nonsense, you know what? I have nothing to say. This is the kind of politics that I don't particularly enjoy or interested in. It just doesn't make sense to me why the EU would stand for it. Why would residents permit it? It sounds appealing that we need to support the musicians, the artists, the photographers, you know, the publishers, the traditional companies in Europe that are employing lots of people and feel that they suffer under this new technology that started, over 20 years ago called the internet. I can feel that. We've seen it in the United States. Industries destroyed completely, right? Bookstores annihilated because of Amazon. The substructure of a lot of industries completely annihilated through the introduction of technologies. The problem is that what they're doing is not going to save them. When you are essentially shielding media companies in the EU from essentially upstarts, small media companies, or large American social media companies, all that you're doing is giving them a temporary boost within the market of the EU, but making them non-competitive outside of it. The goal should be, how do we make our companies in Europe as competitive as possible across the entire world? How do we give them platform and access? How do we break down barriers and make sure that Dailymotion or any other company can outgrow the United States? How can we pass laws that are better than the United States in the sense that they actually permit the sharing of information, that actually consider, you know what, maybe the economics of publishing has changed, and maybe the true pricing on value of some of those material is what somebody's willing to put an advertisement on. Everybody assume that if Spotify pays more than YouTube on a per song basis, that means that YouTube pays too little. Says who? Maybe YouTube's payment is the correct amount, because YouTube payment is actually based on effectively an auction where people are bidding for the price, while something like Spotify is through negotiations. So maybe Spotify is overpaying, but the true price is actually far, far lower, closer to what YouTube is through an unregulated auction house. And when you are forcing companies such as Spotify to pay those kind of prices, and you're trying to force everybody else to do the same, you're putting your social media companies or companies that are reliant on third-party content at a disadvantage, and permitting other companies that are not going to be subject to it out of the United States, Canada, Australia, all over Asia, potentially even South America, to grow a base that will put them in 5-10 years far ahead of the EU. That's usually, at least in my opinion, is usually what happens here. When you try to protect your market, the end result, especially if it's over a long period of time, is that it makes your companies a lot less competitive when it comes to actually competing abroad. Taldran. So if someone uses an internet platform to call in a bomb threat, it is the platform that legally performed the bomb threat. See, that's how absurd that is. But not quite. But the argument is that if you created a video where you calling in a bomb threat, you are effectively saying that the platform is speaking that to the audience. Now, it's obviously not going to work, because this is only related to copyright infringing material, not about not extended to threatening material. But I understand what you're saying. If we want to, we can stretch this out to the most ridiculous extensions and then say that platform are then liable for everything that we say, not just through third-party material, but also every word that I express myself with. You're right. Commissar Keck, does the freedom of expression allow artists to create any kind of art, even though it may be obscene or repulsive to some people? Now, I don't know what the standards are in the EU. In the United States, that has been a battle for a very, very long time of what is ultimately, what did you say? What were the words you were using here? Obscene or repulsive? Not repulsive, but the concept of obscenity has been litigated many, many times. In 1996, part of the Communication Decency Act was Congress. At that time, it was an all-Republican Congress. If you remember 1996, Clinton was in the White House, and you had, I believe, Newt Gingrich in the as Speaker of the House. It was both the Senate and the House was all-Republican. They voted in the Communication Decency Act, basically tried to say what is or is not obscene. Basically say that obscenity deals in local laws. So if I on the internet say something that is obscene, but I said in Florida, I'm in Miami, right? Some things I may say here that is very common but might be considered obscene in Kansas, I might be held liable because it reaches Kansas through the internet and the local law would be then applicable. It went to the Supreme Court, the whole thing was found to be unconstitutional. The only thing that remained actually was that section 230 that provided immunity to the platforms. So there are concept of obscenities and they are, but beside things of, you know, I know it when I see it kind of rules when it comes to obscenities and certain basic things in like involving children, animals, things that are prurient, violence and stuff like that, effectively, yes, artists can express themselves in a myriad of ways without too much concern about obscenity. Again, with very, very few exceptions in the United States. Stylus Box, excuse me, is it going through USA? No, it's in the EU. It's impacting the United States because obviously content creators or anybody that wants to post content online, whether or not it's in video form or even in picture form or in other forms of material through Facebook, Twitter, and United States might be blocked once it enters, you know, the electronic borders of EU. So while it definitely impacts the EU itself and residents and their access to information, it also impacts just about everybody else around the world who might want to speak and be heard within the EU. Stylus Box, is the threatful Article 3 going to the United States? Oh, you mean is it going to come here? There is no way for it to come here. There's zero concern that this will be stretched to the United States. Not only is there no appetite whatsoever within the United States for something like that, different parts of it are completely unconstitutional. The idea, in my opinion, that you can hold a platform to be a speaker because it permits a third-party user to post material directly on them, even if they don't do anything, just give essentially the technological meal for people to post on it, that would be completely unconstitutional. That the idea that ultimately you are liable for somebody else's speech. Not only there's a huge amount of questions about whether or not the speaker itself is permitted to say what they say because of freedom of speech and the concept that you can set up rules ahead of time that prevent them from speaking. That's not permitted in the United States. You cannot create a tax that will prevent speeches. That effectively what they're trying to do through this. So in the United States, this has long been resolved. the idea that first you shift and you say it's not the content creator, but it's the platform that is now is the speaker, and now I can essentially place a tax, a cost on the platform before they're allowed to speak. Those two things would be, in my opinion, unconstitutional within the United States, because one of the things we adopted through the British system is this concept of government-enforced censorship, right? And the one thing that we dropped very, very early on, even when we were just a bunch of colonies, is the idea that the government cannot essentially preemptively stop speech based on some sort of a tax or some sort of a license. And that's effectively what it does here. The government passes a rule that says effectively to these platforms, you cannot speak until you've gotten this kind of a license, until you've paid a fee. Absent that, you have to pay. That kind of rule would never be permitted within the United States. It would be a violation of freedom of speech here. Taldren, would it be easier for YouTube, Facebook, etc. to just withdraw their servers and offices from the EU and not force EU law as US companies? I represent a lot of small to medium-sized companies, and for those kind of companies, the answer is yes. That's what many of them will do. They will say, you know what, I have no people on the ground in Europe, nobody's working there, they can't really enforce anything. I'm basically a US company just transmitting my information, my videos, my blogs, my pictures to the rest of the world. Let them come after me. They have no jurisdiction. They really can't do anything. And in reality, for many of the small creators, that's exactly what it is. Small companies that are setting it up. But Google can't do that. They have massive amount of business all over Europe. So even if they withdraw their servers, they're going to be liable because they're still selling products. They do have research. They have... they may have some retail stores there. They probably have employees. They have people working in universities or in private labs. They try to sell probably some of their products, let's say through their cameras. What are they called? It's not the Ring cameras. Nest cameras and the thermostat. They're probably trying to sell that in Europe. So it's not easy for large companies to just say, you know what? We are going to ignore your law. Withdraw servers. That's not going to get it because they have so much that the local countries can actually grab onto. So they have jurisdiction over the large one. Smaller ones are probably going to do exactly what you said. Commissar Keck, how do you feel about the Internet Bill of Rights to prevent people from being deplatformed and depersoned on the internet, like Alex Jones, for instance? So it depends what you call the Internet Bill of Rights. I had a video on it, I don't know, maybe a month ago, maybe a little longer than that. There are two different implications. The Internet Bill of Rights, as was proposed, kind of like a crowdfunding, but crowd-supported idea, very short proposal about this concept of freedom of speech as presented, that I am not in agreement to. I think it's too narrow, and you think it's giving you what you want, but it's actually harming. I'm opposed to the idea that we just focus on that and in the process help Alex Jones but hurt some of the platform, because I do believe that these platforms as collections of individuals are permitted to express themselves even in doing something that I think is awful, like deplatforming people. I think their actions are terrible, but I don't think they're legally liable for it. But the Internet Bill of Rights is proposed and currently in Congress, that I do support. In Congress right now, they're circulating Internet Bill of Rights where they have essentially 10 different items that are not in, which includes that one provision. But when you read it within the context of all the 10, makes absolute sense, because they talk about privacy, talk about a lot of different issues that are important to so many of you. And it's more about, let's discuss this issue. Let's discuss what guidelines the law can provide when it comes to freedom of speech online and what it means to deplatform people. Start the conversation on those 10 topics that together, maybe you'll agree on 3 of them, that will start the process of creating a bill of rights that I'm absolutely in support of. I'm just not support of a very narrow read that is just meant to say that these platforms are not permitted by law to ban somebody. That I'm not. I just think it needs to be read within the entire context. There's a lot of different provisions, and basically force everybody to actually have a conversation in Congress and actually compromise towards some solutions. Because I think that a lot of times, maybe with history, we know what's right and wrong here, but a lot of time when we look forward, we are not certain what is right or wrong. And some discussion and some compromise, I think, will get us much further than us constantly relying on laws that were put in place before we even know what the internet is. So I hear the problem you're raising, and I'm in support of a solution to it. And I think that these platforms should never deplatform people. Sometimes I think that they it's okay for them to set certain rules and eliminate certain content, but not deplatform people, and definitely not foreclose people's ability to speak through not only this platform, but also through utilization of domain registrar and website servers and credit card processors and everything else. I'm with you on that. I just think that the process has to be much more comprehensive. And an Internet Bill of Rights is presented by Congress that proposes a lot of different subjects for discussion, I think is be much more effective, and it does raise that one issue. And I think we have to have that discussion. Taldren, that's my cue to YouTuber Law. I think that's the one I answered, right? Kilo Sierra Alpha, KSA. Lior, in your opinion, how will the YouTube respond to Article 13? Will they start blocking EU uploads? Maybe block YouTube across all of EU countries? I think that Europe has seen some of the consequence of terrible laws that are designed to prop failing companies and in the same time somehow try to punish innovative internet companies. And they don't have to look far by comparing what has happened in Spain versus what happened in Belgium and in Germany. In Spain, and this is based on the second article here. There's also Article 11 that says that basically says that that if companies like Google actually create snippets of news based on other people's content, they're obligated to pay that newspaper that they're linking to a fee effectively. Spain passed that as a mandatory rule. And as a result, Google said, fine, we're out of here. And they pulled their Google News out of it and saying, we obviously cannot pay every single media company we link to and provide some sort of a blurb on it, because that'll be unmanageable. We'd rather not offer that service at all. So while they are providing the basic web search capability, they don't provide Google News in Spain. And as a result, they did a study on it a few years ago. It showed a marked decline in traffic to all those media companies. You're not going to benefit by trying to tax successful companies out of existence, because they'll just pull back, and your media companies that are complaining that they're not getting paid because YouTube, Google includes some blurb about their article in Google News are not getting the traffic at all. And that's your problem, that all those content creators, the large media companies, do not receive the traffic. When they did something similar in Germany and Belgium, but said it's not obligatory, it's also something that can be subject to negotiations, what you found is that all these large media companies have been complaining, when it came right down to it, agreed to give Google an exemption, because they understand no matter how much money they think they are owed, that they need Google for traffic. Who is going to provide traffic except Google? And I think that's what's going to happen. Google understands its position, YouTube especially, being the second largest search engine in the world after Google itself, that without being able to upload videos, the traffic-driven would just collapse as well. So what will YouTube likely do? They're going to act in such a way that's going to minimize their liability. Because if they don't, the exposure will just be enormous. They'll spend the next 10 years in litigation. In Europe, it'll be unmanageable. They'll have to settle for billions and billions of dollars in fines to European countries. It's just going to be unmanageable for them. So what they're going to do is basically they're going to come to terms with the large media companies and large content creators. And they say, you know what? We are going to allow you to post to our content, to our website. The first time we detect something that it's permissible, we kill it. So you have a privilege, but you know, we're not going to be facing liability. So if you do something wrong here, they include potential infringing material on it, we cut you off, and that's the end of the privilege here. And the ones that are going to suffer are the small content creators. So there'll be stage of adjustment where small content creators will be taken down every single time they upload anything with detected third-party content before it's permitted. So first of all, nobody will be able just to upload. There'll be actually a pause where every single content is going to be scanned and in a much more intensive way. And once detected, a lot of it will just be rejected, and there'll be some sort of a process outside of YouTube through the legal system for small content creators to get some sort of a documentation they can take back to YouTube. YouTube is going to play this game until people call uncle. That's basically what they're doing in Spain when it comes to that. And they say, you know what? If people are not interested in allowing their own creators to create the kind of content that is not infringing, but rather place this enormous burden on them to and prevent them from expressing the same way that the rest of the world wants to do, then we'll play this game. We'll protect our butts, basically, but we'll play your game until you decide otherwise. And I think that's just what's going to happen here. The ones that are going to suffer are the EU residents and the small content creators and the rest of the world as they're trying to push content to Europe. But I think that YouTube can play that game because as much as Europe thinks that this is going to help smaller European platforms, it's going to hurt them in the long run because they'll be giving birth to companies that cannot compete outside of the European borders because they are protected by regulations. And the minute they step out, they're not going to have the kind of reach and the kind of capabilities because they can't compete against companies that are not as heavily regulated. Three 3D video. The comments from Commissar Keck about an Internet Bill of Rights could be better dealt with by updating anti-monopoly laws to recognize the power of the platform that is anti-competitive. I'm not opposed to that. I think that a lot of people would agree with you that the concept of antitrust within the United States has taken a turn over the last 10, 15 years, where they focus specifically on pricing mechanism, and that is not effective in today's world, where they say, you know, the only time we can see negative impact on the consumer is in a pricing mechanism. So when a monopoly, you know, reduces prices to kill competitors, and once everybody is out, raises prices again, that's something that our antitrust laws can deal with. But something like what happens online where everything is provided for free, they can't understand how to deal with it. What's an anti-competitive or monopolistic? What's an illegal monopolistic behavior online when everything is provided for free and there is no way of judging the pricing effect on consumer? So I do think that probably we're due for an update. Again, that requires your congressman to actually get to work and actually do something beside just speaking from the dais and giving speeches and calling people from YouTube and Google and arguing with them nonsensically. It requires them to sit down and guess what? Compromise. Come to a discussion with people from across the aisle and reach a compromise about, okay, nobody gets what they want, but we get just that far. The question is there a stomach? Because that's what really killed, in my opinion, a lot of the effectiveness of Congress that was always ineffective. But the idea that over the last not 20 years, but over the last 10 years of the idea that nobody should ever compromise. Compromise is a four-letter word. The result is nothing ever happens. Eric Ahim Ezel. Even if you pay for it, do we think they'll actually trust your statement that it's licensed? Will they just ding you and force you to respond every time you use the song in your open? You know what? You're right. How will they? I mean, it will work if the company that licensed my music to me is also then signing an agreement with YouTube and then uploading their music to YouTube so YouTube's Content ID can actually run against me. There's no doubt that YouTube is going to run into enormous problem, but what's their solution? To completely shut down, to create a barrier, a digital barrier around Europe and not permit anything in? I don't think they'll go that far. I think that if they can minimize liability to such an extent that it's controllable by dealing only with partners that they feel they can trust, and it's not going to be me, it's going to be large media companies, newspapers, television, movie companies, music companies, that's who they trust, plus very, very large content creators. In their mind, they are controlling liability while basically trying to force the EU to change by showing them this is what the impact is. Right? We cannot allow your small content creators, no matter how much you want us to, we cannot allow them to just upload their videos because you impose all the liability on us. You give us no way of actually getting out of it. You're not telling us, you know, if you do this, you're not liable. At least come up with some sort of a process, like saying, you know what, you need to come up with a scanning capability that provides X and provide 20 different things that the scanning can do. But if you don't even do that, YouTube, I think, is going to play this game. It's not going to leave the market. It's not going to cede the market to local smaller companies. That will make no sense for it. But it will play the game until the EU realizes that what they did was a mistake. I'm sorry. I think I was like looking at the whiteboard rather than you here. I have a whiteboard with a bunch of nonsensical words that I use. And I'm looking there rather than there. I do apologize if I didn't look right at you. Con Clancy, what about if a member states refuse to pass these laws? Okay, so I'm definitely not an expert in EU law. The way I understand it, there's basically a penalty phase, because that's the way the entire legal system works, where they pass the directive and then they have 2 years in which to pass the laws. And there are essentially, my understanding, some sort of a penalty. The penalties that go into effect that gets compounded over time if you fail to pass the law. So there is an enforcement capability within the way they've set up the EU. John Ferguson, what happens if the service providers move their servers outside of the EU, Ukraine, Belarus? Like I said before, that will work for smaller ones, but as long as you are... your company as a whole has physical presence anywhere in the EU, you're still under their jurisdiction. So Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, stuff like that, they have local operations within the EU. So unless they start not just the servers, but actually start moving people outside, that's not going to impact them. So smaller companies can get away with it, but larger companies traditionally can't. David A.E. Levy. Won't this kill many Linux distros? Oh, sure. Many government systems run on various versions of Linux using many different code repositories developed by many different individuals. That's actually an interesting whether or not there is nothing in the law the way it's written now that says that it will not impact code repositories. That it is only for visual content or for auditory content or written content. So you're right. It's possible that this, if you wanted to stretch, if the wording does not get any better, or that some country says that, okay, and actually will extend it to other repositories where, since code is subject to copyright and can be actually be produced by a lot, the question is whether or not then running a repository itself, a library of code, whether or not that's going to be impractical because nobody can be held, nobody can carry the liability associated with code that is provided by ultimately 1,000 different people because it's being grown over time. That's interesting, and I didn't think of that. You're probably correct. Unicorn Sprinkles, don't forget to click thumbs up. Yes, guys, thumbs up, that really, really helps, and just promoting the video and making sure that people see it as it's running. The Sarah Games. This feels like it would kill the Let's Play community here on YouTube. It's such a gray area without written consent from the owner of the IP. Great example. Perfect. That's exactly it. Right now, if I'm YouTube, I do not allow Let's Play. Bar none. Forget it. See, we can have an argument, discussion about what Let's Play and whether or not it's copyright infringement and what is the role of commentary when it's placed on top of copyrighted material, and whether or not as a player I'm directing the story or I'm just revealing a story written by an author. Interesting little argument. But what makes it interesting is there's no way in hell that YouTube can make that determination. You know, our courts really have not looked into it, and even they did, there's no real laws on the subject matter. So unless the European Union passes law that specifically says that Let's Play is not copyright infringement, and so as a result you can allow it, yeah, I think it's pretty much killed. There is no chance for any Let's Play, and that they will not even allow the large YouTubers to do Let's Play. That doesn't make a difference. Because ultimately, all that content is actually copyright protected, and the issue is really at that point whether or not it's fair use or not, and how is YouTube actually going to figure that out. So I'm with you. I think that's going to kill the entire Let's Play community within Europe. Eric Ahim Azel, thank you for your response. Thank you, Nate. What does this mean for the media being able to cover content they call problematic, a la Count Dankula? Isn't quoting him technically infringement since context doesn't matter? See, the problem is that right now when they are based on conversations and things we see outside of it, it seems that they have an intent to actually exempt traditional media from it, meaning that if you are in a company that would be called journal, where your work would be called journalistic or traditional media company, that they may get an exemption from it that allows them to then actually create content based on your content and post it to YouTube without YouTube actually being liable for it. So right now, again, you don't see it in the actual language. The language seems as if it's going to apply to everybody, except for maybe size. So small companies will not be liable. But based on discussions and promises, it seems that they are moving toward the idea of passing a final directive that would actually exempt those media companies. So they'll be able to talk about their opinion of Count Dankula, but you won't. Because your stuff will be taken down by YouTube because they'll be liable. But if, you know, the Financial Times or I don't know, whoever, the Miami Herald, anybody else wants to talk about it, they'll be able to talk. So you'll get their opinion, but you'll be a massive reduction in the opinion as expressed by small content creators. Now, don't get me wrong. It's only to the extent to which you are including content from him. So you'll still be able to speak about what you're doing, but you won't be able to necessarily include content from him unless he then signs a deal with YouTube saying, look, whatever I'm producing, you can allow. You know, and that might be a movement. You know, YouTube says to everybody, look, you want to start creating. Right now, their content ID is really only open to large companies. It's not really effectual against anybody else. But what if YouTube said this? Content creators, you want to make sure that you can do whatever you want in Europe? Give me a license, a free license, effectively, to YouTube, permitting everybody else to use it. In any format, agreeing ahead of time that, and you could put certain rules into it, you know, that everything is going to be fair use. That also allows, now they'll still create rules, not copyright, but rules that allows you to ask them to take it down if somebody reposts your entire video or substantial portion without any commentary, but it will be effectively, you basically are going to agree not to file lawsuit for copyright infringement through that license. And, you know, I would sign something like that. Basically give permission. Why? If you and everybody else does that, it becomes ineffectual. The European system becomes ineffectual because so many producers of content are basically signing away a waiver saying that they will not sue. Because they agree that once they put it on, they are providing a blanket license to anybody to do anything. That, so you already have a license, that's not going to be copyright infringing. So that might be the way to do it. Basically go even to smaller content creators and say, you know what? You want to be able to post it into Europe? You have to give up your copyrights to your content within the European Union as well. That might be kind of a crowd supported mechanism to basically take down the European Union direct Article 13 by everybody signing away and saying we want no copyrights in our content at all. I would do it in a second for if that passes. I have zero problem with something like that. Eric Ahim Azel. Traditional media use a lot of licensed material. How can they reconcile that occurring with no limited oversight but demand this from non-traditional? Because that's what they do. This law is meant to support traditional media, and so the lawmakers are telling us that they're going to create an exemption for traditional media. Makes no sense to you? That's fine, because it makes no sense to anybody else either. But that's effectively what's happening here. They told us that. So effectively they create that kind of exemption for traditional media. It's not going to survive. It's going to be over time undermined. You cannot support these governments cannot support failing businesses. The only way for these businesses to survive is actually to embrace fully digital content and understand that in a world where content is easy and it's so diversified, and the news does not mean that you have to have, you know, 5,000 reporters all over the world, because you can get content from all over the world from individuals that are directly there. You can get pictures from every corner of the world. You don't have to keep those photographers on staff. Once they understand how the digital economy works, they'll be able to compete better. There are companies that compete very, very well. The Wall Street Journal, because they create the kind of content that people understand, and they create value-added content, not just, you know, everyday kind of fluff pieces, but rather value-added content. And they can put a gate and charge people for it. And until all these media companies actually embrace, and the great likelihood is that most will die. So you are slowing down the death of all these media companies, but you're not saving them. The 3D video. The EU wanting more regulations on tech companies means it is impossible for European competition to US companies. They are jealous of the US. There's no doubt. I mean, you have to understand that there are real reasons why the United States dominates when it comes to the internet economy. Not only did it start here, but we traditionally have given, you know, legal cover for these companies. So whenever you're calling for the removal of Section 230, for the removal of some of the protections from these tech companies, understand that that's been a big part of why they were able to grow so successfully, because the law of in our legal system recognized and removed any sort of liability and created a mechanism by which these platforms can allow people to put literally anything on those platforms and not be held liable. Now, we created a few exemptions over time, try to hold them liable for repeat infringement, stuff like that. But in reality, creating a system where you can get people's information and not really be obligated to anything because our privacy laws are so weak, well, that allowed for the growth of Facebook. Allow people to post anything they want to in terms of video content and pictorials, and you just created YouTube and Instagram. You say that your defamation laws are weak because ultimately you place free speech above everything else. Well, that led to the growth of Twitter. But when you don't have in other countries at extreme equivalents to those US, yes, other countries have free speech. It's nothing compared to what free speech is in the United States. Not even close. We've seen that in the UK and their prosecution of Count Dacula. Definitions of free speech in Europe does not resemble what it means in the United States. Nobody has the kind of absolute immunity to liability that the United States has with Section 230 that the platforms have enjoyed. So you have to recognize whether that many people have a problem with them because they feel that allows these companies to get away with murder, basically by deplatforming people, by potentially censoring some speech. At the same time, it's what allowed them to absolutely dominate in the market. You know, you have to make a decision of what's more important, and maybe can you add certain regulation at this stage that is not going to somehow hamper their growth in the future. Poetry Queen, hello, how you doing? Will this only affect the European Union or the whole of Europe? It affects the entire world to the extent to which anybody wants to send content into Europe to have their content viewed within Europe or have their content monetized. So assume that you're a content creator, you're creating videos and you're monetized on YouTube, you're in North America, in Europe, outside of the European Union, in Asia, and you want to send your stuff into Europe, you most likely have to change some of the content, and you may have to have it demonetized as well. So most likely you're looking at less views and less money coming out of it, because there is a substantial portion of any single video that comes outside of your own jurisdiction, comes out of the EU. This King, I heard even if Article 13 will go through EU Parliament, it still can be fought in court because of the breach of privacy, scanning everything, or am I wrong? I can't speak to that. I know that they have a provision in it that's intended not to undermine some of the progress they're making on privacy, so they're trying to exempt that issue. But whether or not the impact will be a violation of privacy through scanning, I don't know. But the intention in Parliament is to exempt, to not have the copyright law actually infringe on the privacy regulations that they've passed. But I'm not sure how they'll do that. I mean, that's what we don't have right now. It's an intention, but what does that mean? If effectively I can scan and store all information based on what you've created so that I can prove infringement down the line, if that's what's needed, I cannot see how you not violate some privacy laws through the scanning and the gathering of information on individuals, because that may be in conflict with the idea that people can be forgotten, that people in Europe can ask you to remove their information that you're storing on them and stuff like that. So good point. But at this point, we just don't know because it hasn't been finalized. Bang's naughty bits. Since the data on the internet is routed in an irregular, unpredictable way, is there liability if the actual data packets pass through the EU restricted zone in passing? That's interesting. The way I'm reading the law, the directive, the article, sorry, and it's bad because it's so generalized. They obviously do not want to give us too much detail, and they're using inconsistent wording, like I showed you, protected work versus works, protected content versus works versus copyrighted. You don't know what is what. So there's a lot of confusion as what they mean, is actually what they mean. But the way that I'm reading the language right now, it seems to be liability based on where the content is viewed, not where the content is passed. So even if it goes through a server, the idea is, because that's what they're saying, is that the platform is communicating with the user. So it's possible. So to me, it seems to mean that it's based on where the user is, not where the platform is, not where the servers are, not where the packets pass through, but where the user is. So an American on vacation in England watching something that is permitted in the United States may, as a result, cause liability for a company, because in the EU, technically, that American can actually be the basis for copyright infringement against content that otherwise is not permitted in the EU, if that makes sense. Kale Serpent, can the US take away protections for these platforms and basically make the platform a publisher just like any a host for others? Yes, I mean, it has to do a couple of things. First of all, it has to repeal Section 230. That's an act of Congress. This is nuts. All of these are acts of Congress. The courts can't do it, okay? Congress enacted all these laws, created all those exemptions. They're the only one who can pass it because none of this stuff is unconstitutional. So the you first have to remove the umbrella, basically the indemnification that provided through Section 230. That removes protection, but then you still have to create a law that says that there is a differential between publisher and editor online. So you'd still have to create that. Now, there is an argument to be made that if you remove Section 230, it would fall back to the standard as it was back in 1996. But that's not necessarily a given. We've had so much legal precedent since that time that said that there's absolute immunity, that I think that they would have to pass a law that says that there is a differential between publisher and editor online. Because the way courts have come to it in the United States, some of it ruled based on Section 230 that you can get rid of, but many of them said it's just free speech and you cannot get away from that. So can you do it? Yes, it's quite possible that after you do this, after you get rid of Section 230 and after you pass a law that says that online there'll be a differential between editor and publisher, that in some cases, at least, the courts will come back and say it's a violation of First Amendment speech, because these platforms, in removing, deplatforming, censoring, demonetizing, they're expressing their right of free speech, because corporations have a right to free speech, which is identical to what individuals Americans have. So it's possible, but I think you're still looking at a fight through federal courts to see whether or not free speech would still protect them. Nate, can the passage of these articles and who they affect settle the argument of whether these companies are publishing a platform in the US in regard to censorship the platform? No, none of that will have any impact on the United States. Like I just said, for that to happen, first of all, get rid of Section 230, pass a law differentiating it, and then get ready for battle in the Supreme Court, because there's many cases that says we don't even need Section 230. We can rely on the First Amendment and the basis and the free speech itself. Nobel Savage, which states are you licensed in? California and in Florida. Commissar Keck, thank you for always taking the time to address our question. Make sure to smash the like button, everyone. Thank you so much. Yes, if you guys can click like, that'd be a big, big help. Thank you. Travelers, one out of two. If Article 13 passes in January, and if it has such as much a negative effect on Europe as it is currently speculated it might, would legal procedure to repeal Article 13 even be viable? In other words, if voted in and over time found to be damaging, would the European Union be able to undo the potential damage Article 13 may do toward itself and its people? I think the answer to it, yes, you can always repeal laws there. Can you reverse the damage? I mean, that's the problem here. And the question is how long it actually drags on. Because we've seen it in other examples where when you try to create a protectionist environment that supports your companies, in the beginning, it seems like you're making money, but over time, you're creating incredibly uncompetitive companies that simply cannot compete outside of the protection provided by the laws, and so are just not able to compete around the world with more nimble companies they are just able to do more. Not to mention that, as one person proposed, there might be repercussion from other companies. If you say, hold on a second, you're not allowing our content creators to express themselves freely in your country, we're going to do the same. And as a result, markets for European content maybe they get limited as well. And if European companies have to abide by the rules, do they then have to abide by the rules when they are sending their content outside of the European Union? Because if the rest of the world doesn't have to abide by their rules, think about stuff like Let's Play, right? So that's simple. That would mean that Europeans are not allowed to do any Let's Play, even when they are broadcasting their content outside of Europe at all. That you can see how, even from a creative standpoint, how non-competitive European creators would become if this law is taken to the extreme. Again, I think that what's going to happen is platform will react in such a way that lowers their liability. But over time, I think this will be repealed. I think this will be overturned. I think this makes absolutely no sense. I think countries will realize that this is harmful to them. Hopefully they do it sooner than later and they'll try to amend the rules. But I don't think that the bottom is going to fall out. I don't think that it's going to be devastating for Europe. And why? Because creators will adjust. They'll find different creative ways of communicating, of saying what they want to say, and it will force them to adjust. Over time, it might be repealed, the law, but I think that it will not have the outright, you know, destructive impact that most people think it will be, because it doesn't happen in a vacuum. People adjust to it and find new ways to express themselves, to create content. So I think that we're creative people by nature. We'll find a way around any law. Taldren, you didn't get into Brexit and how that affects Article 13. Do you think this would push GB toward a no-deal Brexit? Okay, so like I said, I'll propose a Brexit discussion for another time. But do I think it impacts it? Look, I think that there's a lot of things that are pushing the UK toward Brexit. I think this highlights some of the problem that many, many in the UK see with their entire association with the European Union over the many years. Let me just make a statement as me, right? This is just my American view of not just Brexit, but of the entire creation of the European Union. I apologize for it. As purely as an American, I never understood how an independent country is willing to give up sovereignty to a central non-national entity. People try to compare that to the United States. False. The European Parliament has in no way compared to the federal government in the United States. the colonies in the United States were never independent country, not for more than 5 seconds. Basically, they were under one control or another. They found value in gathering together because there was strength in first setting up an army and fighting for their independence, and later on it was in their interest in an attempt to create a single national country and divide control between state and federal government. This is not Europe at all, where you have independent countries that have been independent and successful and have battled each other for centuries, them giving up their right to make determinations for their own citizens. The process made no sense to me. So I'm coming from a position of an American not really understanding how, for economic reason more than anything else, because you always had national defense alliances, how for economic reasons and the desire to, as a whole, compete against what's happening in the United States and some places in Asia, you would create that kind of a union. And I think that this problem highlights what's going on here, because they are, every country in Europe has their own idea. Some are more comfortable with the directive as a whole, the copyright directive. Some are less comfortable in it. They all want something else because they see how it might potentially impact their own citizenry. And as a result, this is what you get, this kind of fluffy directives that don't really say much, and then force the individual countries to come back and pass laws that might be contrary to what their own citizens actually want. Because as part of their centralized government out of Belgium, the only way to get it, they have two options. Oppose it or agree to something so broad that it's unclear what they agree to. And in this case, this is what happened here. But the impact is devastating. You all agree to something so fluffy without any real detail, which ultimately will drive every single country to create its own separate laws that somehow are linked but through commonality of restrictions, even though the details will be different. I don't think it benefits any single country as a whole. There might be some countries, obviously, that benefit from the centralization of power within the European Union. I don't think it's beneficial to them. I think this will serve as greater impetus for potentially supporting Brexit. I think that I think if the British needed more impetus to leave the European Union, this is just in support of them, because more things that I think make no sense at all, and the idea that they now should create this kind of ridiculous rules based on some generalized idea that's coming out of Belgium, I think makes no sense. Well, it makes no sense. Now, I'm not diminishing the incredible cost it will take and the impact it will have on the UK economy if they left the European Union with or without a deal. I think that the impact will be tremendous. But as a citizen, I can see why so many voted for exiting the European Union. You can have an argument about what people knew, what they didn't know, whether or not they were blindsided, didn't really understand the impact on it. That's great. Democracies vote, and not always everybody have full knowledge of what they're voting on. Well, that's just the way things happen. But I see that what's happening with this copyright directive just highlights why some of the problems with belonging to this kind of a system, where you are an independent country that's giving up sovereignty over matters that are so critical to your own citizenry. And when you see differently than others, how you might still be forced to adhere to rules that are contrary to what's beneficial to your own citizenry. And I don't think it's just the UK. I think this is going to support other EU exit movements across Europe. Heather Tracy, YouTube and Google bend over for this nonsense and goodbye free speech. It's not bending over. It's money, right? Google will support free speech as long as it's making money, and it will stop supporting free speech when it stops making the money. That has been they've done that across the world, you know, with their interactions with China, for instance. They'll stand on principles until they realize they need to get back into the market and make money. Here, this is just the liability is too huge. Literally, this is the kind of liability that can kill a company. This kind of massive liability where anytime somebody puts something on your platform, you are now the speaker of whatever is being placed on it in terms of liability. So they have to play the game. And the impact on free speech, at this point, you can't blame Google on it. You've got to push it back on the European Parliament. It's their decision. Pro gamer Eric, this is some extra dumb stuff they do not need to freaking add. I don't disagree with you, but we also in the United States have a lot of idiotic rules and laws that have been passed over time, because you have to understand that big money then lobby Congress and they're supporting, right? Chances are you are not lobbying Congress and you are not taking your local congressman to dinner to talk about this kind of stuff. And all these other companies are. That's why you're getting ridiculous copyright laws that last for over 100 years. You get a lot of ridiculous nonsense because they're being pushed and lobbied for by companies with lots and lots of money. In this case, in Europe, they're being lobbied for by the music industries and large media companies that are dying because they can't adapt to the changing internet world. Ted Ingalls, would this then extend to reaction videos? Absolutely. There'll be no reaction videos, no reaction videos. Because every reaction video arguably uses copyright information, and then YouTube has to make a decision about whether or not that's fair use. And how long are they going to spend on any single reaction video to decide that? They cannot spend more than a second of a computer time on it. They have to take it down, create a buffer, and then prioritize who's going to go through this first. Everybody's taken down, and then prioritize large media companies, prioritize large content creators that have a certain trusting relationship, kick out most of other people to let them go through some sort of the state mediated process. But it's the only thing they can do. They have to create a buffer. The concept of just uploading something directly to YouTube is, for all practical purposes, going to die. It's just, that cannot be accomplished if YouTube has to scan from top to bottom and match all information on a massive scale. You know, it's going to create a pipeline here, a blockage in the pipe, and it's going to allow only the largest one to really get through it. I can only imagine how long it will take between upload and actual going live on YouTube if you're within the European Union. The 3D video on the Linux thing, if the vagueness remains and the distros are blocked, then mission critical system may be unable to be updated, leading to national security issues due to risk of hacks. Potentially, but then again, if the liability is on the platform carrying the code, since those are decentralized in the sense that none of them, I don't know, but maybe some of them have European employees and stuff, but most of them are decentralized, meaning independent people contributing to it. As long as you keep those servers outside of Europe and there is no direct employee-employer relationship, that is something you might be able to ignore the European regulation and say, you know what, who you're going to go after exactly here, you know? Doesn't mean that the EU cannot sue, but they'll be suing some of these libraries of code that do not in themselves like hold valuable assets and that they can be sued for. You're right, it might, but I think that companies will react by just moving out. Something Facebook, YouTube, Google cannot do but something that smaller companies might be able to just extricate themselves completely. And as long as they don't have employee-employer relationships within Europe, no direct offices, no assets in Europe, move their servers, they might be able to effectively avoid it. Not legally avoided, they're still liable, but might be effectively avoided, saying, you know what, as long as I move my, I don't have any direct employee-employer relationship, maybe some contributors through Europe, but not really that kind of employee, nobody that can be sued, no assets that can be attached in Europe, I might be able to effectively avoid it, because who's going to go after me? And sorry, and one more thing, we go back to something else I said, is it's, if what I would then do is change the very, licenses used in gathering the code and write new licenses that basically say that as a contributor to the code, I renounce any and all copyrights. If you renounce copyrights in it, effectively make it either a public domain, but effectively give it to away to the public, that's not the way the license is written right now, then there can't be any copyright infringement. So the liability is gone. And that's the only way to contribute to the platform. So yeah, I would probably move my library offshore, sever any sort of relationship I have to any European company that might be supporting the library itself. But then when I'm dealing with any new contribution, make sure that everybody that wants to contribute signs essentially a renunciation of their of any copyright whatsoever, effectively giving it over to the public domain. Conclanseth, what if YouTube gives a fair use license to creators and then refuses to allow European media corporations to post? It could, but I can't see YouTube trying to teach Europe a lesson by excluding content that they can make money off of. I think that ultimately Google is motivated by money. And if there's an exemption for traditional media company from music companies, it's going to bring them in and try to monetize and make money off of it and try to make as much money as possible while excluding the content that creates them, gives them the most liability. So even though that would be kind of an interesting move, I don't see it happening because Google, I don't see Google willingly taking so much money off the table. I think with Google News, it was easy. It wasn't a money making. It wasn't something that was making them much money. So it wasn't a big deal. But when it comes to content creation and being blocked on Europe, I think that I think that they would continue working with the large media companies. Again, I think that there is a way around when it comes to YouTube, and then if you can get enough of a buy-in from the smaller content creators that contribute a lot of the work, that at least among themselves, if they would renounce their copyrights to YouTube, essentially, then they would say that any content created by any of these small content creators cannot be the subject of any copyright claim because essentially it becomes public domain, then you have a huge reservoir of information of original content by all these creators that can be uploaded and shared and uses the basis for other videos, and that can create effectively a community itself. So YouTube might try to be a little more innovative and see if the crowd would support them in that respect. Jonathan Giglio, great. So YouTube maintain its monopoly while small guys can get started. YouTube maintain its monopoly because today it doesn't make any real sense to start a new video sharing service that effectively provides what YouTube provides unless there's something else. You know, Amazon can do that. They have the money and wherewithal, and they can try to out innovate YouTube and pour money into content creators and monetize some of the videos and create the tools for smaller ones to actually compete is highly unlikely. They have to be different, you know. Until Facebook bought Instagram, Instagram was the biggest threat to Facebook. It didn't have to become a better Facebook. It had to do something better than them, which was obviously realize that the number one shared things on Facebook is actually photos. So just focus on that, not build. If I can tell you stories about different clients of mine that tried to be the better Facebook early on and just couldn't compete, and some of them received millions of dollars in venture capital and support. They've had a lot of success, brought in some amazing people. Sometimes the market is satisfied with a certain player like Facebook, and just there is no room to become a tinier Facebook just because I'm providing some different rules here. And I think that's the reality. The competitor to YouTube, my opinion, will not look like YouTube. It'll be something different that people don't haven't thought of yet. Vine could have, if had it lasted, could have been something like that, something different, providing something a little more unique. Eric Ahim Ezel. Last one for me, I swear. Your necklace is inside your shirt, not outside of it, and it's wicking me out. I do apologize. People tell me that every single time. Thank you. Pro gamer. Eric, I think. Okay, I see below there. Nate, what does this mean for crypto and blockchains where ownership is transitory and diffuse? I mean, right now, that's not a, as far as I can see, let me know, that's not a huge issue for content, right? Now, if it's platforms, see, that's interesting. I'm not sure if it changes the argument from their perspective, because their laws are focused on is content that is being shared to the general usage population, not even one-on-one, but rather being broadcast to people at large. So cryptocurrencies, when used as a currency, shouldn't change the formula. Now, if it's the cryptocurrency itself, right? Could that be the subject of copyright issues here? Could be. Right now, it's kind of a stretch if you think about how it works. But arguably, you should be able to use Article 13, even if somebody effectively recreates somebody else's crypto as a different currency. I have to think about it a little more here. It's an interesting question. I'm not seeing right now a problem that the EU law would treat it somehow differently. But I have to think about, maybe there would be a different one. Sorry. Pro gamer Eric, time to use an online video converter to cherish all the videos you love. It might be. You might have to download this stuff. Taldren. So why would Google, Facebook, etc. just block access to EU, stating the hardship of Article 13? Seems easiest way to get rid of this is to call their bluff. They can't make them provide. They could. I mean, that is the easiest, except it's going to cost them more money than they want to bear. Don't forget, they make money off of advertisement, and if there is X number of dollars going into their. They're not making money directly off of your content, right? If there's $1,000 of advertising going into YouTube content, their YouTube's hope is that if they keep a large enough of content on their platform inside the EU that is still attractive to people, they can still essentially cover that content with the same amount of money. Obviously, over time, there'll be less attraction to the content. The contract would not be as entertaining, is not be as meaningful, and maybe not even as educational. So they will have to suffer with less and less money. But why they wouldn't just call it quits there? Because it's going to be a lot of money, and so they're hoping to not lose as much. Jonathan Giglio, we would have a hard time in this country if the phone company said they are exercising their free speech right and kick you off of your phone service. You're right, except that the phone company is effectively a common carrier. They carry communication unadulterated from one end to the next. They're not providing you with services on top, not the extent to which they are. And the argument will be that, well, there are some minimal services being provided on top of them. The argument will be that they can discriminate when it comes to those services. But when it comes to pure communication, they are a common carrier, and they cannot discriminate based on, you know, race, color, and the like. You don't have that. I don't want to keep repeating it because I know many people are opposed to the idea, but you don't have that kind of common carrier with the infrastructure of the internet. It's called net neutrality. So the idea that you somehow going to carry it over to the services provided on top of that, to me, doesn't seem logical. I think you have to start with net neutrality. And to, just like a phone, any dumb pipeline to just carry communications have to be non-discriminatory in nature regardless. And I would extend it far beyond just the known discrimination category. I would say that you're not allowed to discriminate at all. It's harmful to society at all. And then you can have an argument about whether or not services placed on top of them, some of the communications enabled on top of the internet itself, like Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, whether or not there should be a higher level of regulations on them because of the similarity. Ultimately, it is about communication and should be treated the same. But it's because you do have the FCC regulating telephone because it's a common carrier, and you don't have the FCC regulating internet service providers because our FCC decided it's not a common carrier. Look up, lift up. Thank you, YouTuber Law. Thank you. You are over my head. Everyone, have a happy Thanksgiving. Have a happy Thanksgiving to you too. The Banded Panda. Would it be possible for YouTubers to move out of the EU and keep uploading per use of VPN? I think that you will see more and more people doing just that. More and more European deploy. I think it'll be a great time to be a VPN. They'll have to keep on top of it and try to evade the censors from YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter. But nonetheless, I think more and more Europeans are going to adopt VPN, both as content creators and as viewers. And it'll be a battle as YouTube and everybody else is going to try to find way to catch you. And you're going to try to find more and more ways to get away with it. Travelers, thank you so much for answering my questions. You're welcome. This King. Is there an opt-out for Article 11 because I want my stories to be shared? It would bug competitive edge against those big ones. Right now, there isn't. That's the whole point, that when Spain did it, it wasn't an opt-out and Google News left. Germany and Belgium had opt-out. As a result, everybody opted out because Google, everybody wants the traffic coming out of Google. And so, unless something changes, there probably will not be an opt-out, because that's, they have learned that that just undermines their entire thing, that they want there not to be an opt-out, so that it will, how would I say it? If everybody opts out, but I don't, nobody's going to carry my news and nobody's going to pay me for anything, because they could just ignore me, get equivalent news from everybody else. So the only way it's going to work for the few that actually want it is to create a mandatory system where all snippets have to be paid for. This king is streamlining the market with the same rule. I'm not sure what we're saying here. Bandit Panda, could an EU citizen just use an American VPN to bypass a law? If not, will most content creators have to move out of the EU? No, nobody's going to move. I think you're right. I mean, it's not bypassing the law, it's hiding from the law. But I think that, like I said, we're adaptive. So some content creators will adapt their content to include less and less third-party content, but nonetheless still create content based on it. So you'll criticize a movie or review a movie without it showing too many pictures, unless you're getting those pictures from some sort of paid through service or some so that would be one way of adapting. Another one is that more and more people will get VPN, both as content creators and as viewers, to try to bypass the law, in the sense that try to hide from the law, so you don't get caught. I think it's be a good time to be a VPN. It's also going to be a good time to be one of those companies if you can get a deal with, let's say, with a lot of photographers and a lot of music companies and a lot of TV shows and movies to license to people little snippets in exchange for either a per snippet basis or on a monthly basis. More and more those companies will come to the fore, because it's the only way you'll be able to get third-party content through the YouTube censor, is because those company will have already their content ID with YouTube, and your content will then pass through the small hole that they're creating through the funnel, as opposed to getting kicked out. So it will just end support. You can argue that it will end up supporting things that are not, they don't produce market value, right? So too many regulations support activity that doesn't have market value. There's absolutely purpose to VPN. I've used it many, many times for security reasons. But more and more people will have to use VPN in order to do things that are absolutely legal, which for which they don't really need VPN, but because they can get their content onto YouTube, even though their content is perfectly legal. So a lot of the usage, so VPN will benefit from something that does not have economic value at all. Same thing with these kind of repository of third-party licensed content. They'll benefit a great deal, even though I don't need to go to you for a snippet from a movie then and pay for it, because I can actually use it because it's fair use. But if I try to rely on fair use, I may get kicked out and have to go through an entire process by getting it back up on YouTube, where if I go to you, I can just pay for it one time and make sure that my content is on. So there'll be adjustments in the market that create a lot of money for things that don't have really any market value. So they're not gonna improve competitiveness in the European Union, just create, needless work that nobody else needs, but somebody you're gonna profit from. The 3D video, could the EU start blocking websites over Article 13? The answer is yes, because you can block websites to the extent to which your website has some sort of a comment section or an area where people can post to it, because that's ultimately Article 13 is, because it then can place the liability on you. So if I have a website, maybe I will allow typed word, but maybe not allow any pictures or allow any videos to be posted through the commentary section on it, because that might create liability for me. Or I might be able to get out of it, because as a website, I might be considered a small company, because there'll be a size differential. Sorry, my God, sorry. There'll be some exemption for smaller companies versus large companies. Again, as we read, it's really not clear how they're going to differentiate based on size yet. So it's possible that you can get out of it also because you're small. 3D video, thank you for answering the question. Thank you, Taldrin. Oh, we're up on 2 hours here already. Oh, we're at the end here, no problem. Taldrin, what about internet-based phone company? Those communications are cached and sometimes stored per law depending on your country and your server. Could they be considered providers by this? No, not generally, because it's not a I see what you're saying here. If what if I through internet phone service I am communicating recorded video like music, is it a at that point you could argue that you could use that? Yes, I haven't heard somebody try to do it from an efficiency standpoint, but arguably yes, if I want to use internet telephony in order to distribute copyrighted information like music, probably Article 13 would apply. Chris Stott, is free speech fundamentally incompatible with all platforms funded by advertising? No, not at all. Is free speech incompatible? It's a great point. The thing is that if you are, how would I say it? YouTube could make a decision to run their platform completely differently and yet still cater to advertisers without any real concern. See, I disagree with a lot of people that feel that monetization is a right here. I think that YouTube can create a situation where distribution through YouTube becomes a right, for which they will not drop you based on content, but yet create effectively silos that are managed by the users that will determine whether or not it's monetized. You have a right to speak. I don't have the obligation to listen to you. But YouTube does not give me a right to create a circle of the kind of music I want to listen to, the kind of content I want to view, who I don't want to, how to block specific people, specific content from it. Right now, and they do it because they feel that they are better at curating, they want to choose what to put in front of me. Based on my interest, they want to introduce me to some new things and they want to throw at me more and more things that will keep me on their platform. That way, but in that kind of a system, they have to consider everything to be a singular system and everything monetized effectively, because the advertiser basically can touch everything because YouTube is in control. YouTube is the curator. But if they changed the model and allowed me to be the curator, I can actually determine what to see, what not to see, kind of like a TV channel. You know, I can create silos. They can then decide, you know, this is a zone of complete free speech where we do not allow anybody over under a certain age, where we would never allow any sort of monetization unless the advertiser specifically requests to be able to monetize that section. They can create those kind of silos where just because somebody wants to speak does not mean that the world has to answer to them, but still gives them a platform. But YouTube decides that, you know, it's probably going to make them more money if they directly curate it versus giving you as the viewer the power to curate your own videos, your own music, your own entertainment. And I think that you could make money off of it, mainly advertising and computer free speech, but it's a choice by YouTube on Google of this is how we're going to make money. It's true about Twitter and Facebook too, that their curation is what keeps people on their platform. It's not you individually that curates your own information that's going to keep them on top. So they did studies and they feel that you're going to stay longer based on how they determine. And so, but that's a choice. It's not necessarily an incompatibility, in my opinion. Travelers. You mentioned earlier that YouTube were to have its content creator base sign a document allowing all their contents to be free to use for everyone. That this might help subvert the problem imposed by Article 13, but what about video footage of people recorded in the public sphere, i.e. footage of pedestrian in the background of someone else's recording who never provided consent to them being recorded? Would that pose a problem to the solution? It might be, but it's not necessarily a copyright problem. There might be other issues, and I'm not aware of what it means to accidentally record somebody in the European Union on the street in the United States. It's definitely not a copyright issue. Okay. there might be, let's say, privacy issues if I'm using a telephonic lens and I'm on the street looking into somebody's apartment. That might be an issue, but it's not copyright issues. Could there be copyright issues? Yes. What if, you know, there is a main street here in Miami Beach called Lincoln Road, where not only we have a lot of shops, we often have musicians playing music. When they are performing music, especially if they're recording their own music while they're performing live, that will be copyright. If you are walking by it and you are, let's say, purposely recording them, it's quite possible that you are then going to be infringing. That's kind of like the issue here. You're right that it's quite possible that the individual who is submitting what was relinquishing copyrights might himself then actually violate copyright laws in some sense. That right. What would happen is that when YouTube, it doesn't solve the problem, but the idea is if YouTube then, you know, starts building a database based on content creator by small creators, it then scans it all, kicks out still anything that seems to them to be part of a third-party content. So they hear music that they don't recognize or they can't match against a library. They see a photograph or a clip that they can't match against their content ID, that they would kick it out. But in the process, they will take everything else that they have accumulated, and over time it will grow and create essentially a public domain library of content within YouTube Europe, where that will be accessible for anybody to use. So they could subvert it over time, given the amount of content being created every single minute on YouTube. They'll still block a lot of people and will take time to build it. But that's the idea, that if people en masse, because you got so many people that are going to be damaged by it, by this article, if they give up copyrights to YouTube, and YouTube, yes, it will eliminate things that would not fit within its own, that its content ID, whatever the new system actually catches, but it will still be able to build a massive database that other people will be able to use within YouTube, and then YouTube would then, so, you know, it's, if, I'll give you an example. A video game developer produces some snippets of them playing on their video game, submits it to YouTube, it becomes public domain. So a lot of people that are then reviewing the games can rely on those videos in their review, and in the process, you know, And that's how it's going to become essentially public domain material that can be used over and over again. Now, that developer can accomplish the same thing, but actually giving a license through YouTube for everybody to do it. But that would be the idea, you know, that rather than they can work by trying to get licenses from everybody, but also then encourage people in their creation of content to give up their claims to copyright. That's the idea behind it. Again, not a solution, but just a way of trying to undermine the entire system. The banded panda. How is all this going to affect other countries like America? And if you get caught using a VPN, could legal action be taken? right now, the answer is no. The VPN does not create liability for you. It would create liability for YouTube if somebody can show that a percentage of its people are using VPN as a way of getting around it, and is YouTube not catching them. It's possible that YouTube can be more liable, but not necessarily the individual, because you're not technically doing something illegal by using a VPN. It's going to impact the rest of the world because everybody wants to send content into Europe, and so they will have to adjust to a new reality of, because their content is going to be blocked by YouTube as well. So everybody's going to be impacted. Poetry Queen, thank you for answering all of our questions. Have a great day. Thank you so much. We're done. That a little over 2 hours. I really appreciate you guys coming here tonight. Next week, same time, same place. Thank you so much, guys, and have a great night. Have a great Thanksgiving.
Ja, dette ble jo vist etter sluttekstene i kaffebloggen på søndag. Så man får vel ta det med i kaffebloggen på ja, neste dag. Det blir vel mandagen, tenker jeg da. Det blir vel i morgen. Dere ser at kunsten er vekke. Alt sammen. Både bilde og radio uten øks. Og belken modem. Så man får vel gjerne stille det ut nytt. Da, tror jeg. Ja, da var søndagens annen utstilling klar. Det er tre objekter. Man kan jo starte da med delt stereo høyttaler. Replika av radio uten øks. Og et nytt fantastisk arbeid av Knut Larsen i brunt og blått uten titel i titelen på det. Ja, solen er på vei til å trenge seg gjennom disdekket. Tror vi får en veldig fin dag her i Merida. Ja, dette her det var det hadde seg sånn etter sluttekstene vedlegg til kaffebloggen på søndag. Men jeg får vel ta det med ja, skal vi si på mandag også, i hvert fall i neste blogg. For vi må jo vise kunsten til krøllen til alle. Ja, en sånn liten stund etterpå så er det noen som har klagt på kunsten og kom tilbake og levert den tilbake til galleriet. Så nå står det to bilder til salgs på søndags ettermiddag.
Hej kära publik, hjärtligt välkomna. Vi ska kora skönhetsdrottningen mitt framför era ögon. Vilken härlig publik ni är! Skulle få bestämma i världen. Vad menar du skulle vara annorlunda då?
Jag syns det är himla dumt med krig och fred och religion och politik och så. Och så syns det är himla viktigt att skönheten kommer inifrån.
Kaffebloggen i HD och utan ljudcensur finner du på YouTube.
If you don't have any art, you're pretty much lost.